Good morning. Good morning. And welcome to the Cathedral of St. Jude the Apostle. Today we will celebrate Palm Sunday of the Passion of the Lord, the commemoration of the Lord's entrance into Jerusalem. With today's liturgy, we begin the solemn observance of Holy Week. The liturgy can be found in your books, starting on page 86. In the spirit of today's Passion Liturgy, and to signify the beginning of this most solemn, holiest of weeks, there will not be a closing hymn. We ask that you leave after the bishop in silence. Thank you. Please rise and face the baptismal font.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And
dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery. That is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. I invite you now to hold your palms up for the blessing. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. word be in your heart and on your lips, that you may proclaim the gospel worthily and well.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus and the disciples drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tethered and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them here to me. And if anyone should say anything to you, reply, 'The master has need of them.' Then he will send them at once." This happened so that what had been spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. "Say to daughter Zion, 'Behold, your king comes to you, meek and riding on an ass, and on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had ordered them. They brought the ass and the colt and laid their cloaks over them, and he sat upon them. The very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and strewed them on the road. The crowds preceding him and those following kept crying and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds replied, "This is Jesus the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us now go forth in peace.
Number 141.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who has an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross. Graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning he opens my ear, that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore, I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Among them, and for my vesture they assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, give glory to him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with men something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
According to Matthew. One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that time on, he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said,
"Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He said,
"Go
Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, the teacher says, my appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.
The disciples then did as Jesus had ordered and prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at table with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me.
Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him, one after another,
surely, it is not I, Lord.
He said in reply,
he who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born.
Then Judas, his betrayer, said in reply,
surely, it is not I, Rabbi.
He answered,
you have said so.
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and giving it to his disciples, said,
take and eat. This is my body.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying,
drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on I shall not drink this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father.
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
this night all of you will have your faith in me shaken. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him in reply,
though all may have their faith in you shaken, mine will never be.
Jesus said to him,
amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me three times.
Peter said to him,
even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you.
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
sit here while I go there and pray.
He took along Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them,
my soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me.
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will.
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
so you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour. Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again,
my Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done.
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again, and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them,
are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and the elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying,
the man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him.
Immediately he went over to Jesus and said,
"Hail, Rabbi."
And he kissed him. Jesus answered him,
"Friend, do what you have come for."
Then, stepping forward, they laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand to his sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the high priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came who stated,
"This man said, 'I can destroy the temple of God and within 3 days rebuild it.'"
The high priest rose and addressed him,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I order you to tell us under the oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him in reply,
"You have said so. But I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his robes and said,
"He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witnesses? You have now heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?"
They said in reply, "Then they spat in his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying, 'Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over to him and said, but he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
'I do not know what you're talking about.'
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, 'Again he denied it with an oath,
I do not know the man.'
A little later, the bystanders came over and said to Peter, 'At that, he began to curse and swear,
I do not know the man.'
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken, 'Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and began to weep bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done, he returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
"I have sinned in betraying innocent blood."
They said, flinging the money into the temple, he departed and went off and hanged himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, but said, after consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why that field, even today, is called the Field of Blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. And they took 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by some of the Israelites, and they paid it for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded me. Now, Jesus stood before the governor, and he questioned him.
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus said,
"You say so."
And when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many things they are testifying against you?"
But he did not answer him one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. And when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
"Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus called Christ?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that he had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him." The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply,
"Which of the two do you want me to release to you?"
They answered,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to them,
"Then what shall I do with Jesus called Christ?"
They all said, but he said,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder. When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves."
And the whole people said in reply, then he released Barabbas to them. But after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak about him. Weaving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head and a reed in his right hand. All kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, they spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of his cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they came to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he had tasted it, he refused to drink. After they had crucified him, they divided his garments by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And they placed over his head the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads, saying, "Likewise, the chief priest with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, The revolutionaries who were crucified with him also kept abusing him in the same way. From noon onward, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said, "Immediately, one of them ran to get a sponge. He soaked it in wine and, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. But the rest said, But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit." Please kneel. Please stand. And behold, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, rocks were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the men with him who were keeping watch over Jesus feared greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening, and they said, God. There were many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph. He was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in a clean linen and laid it in a new tomb which he had hewn in the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance of the tomb and departed. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there facing the tomb. The next day, one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, Pilate said to them,
"The guard is yours. Go, secure it as best you can."
So they went and secured the tomb by fixing a seal to the stone and setting the guard. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. My dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, I welcome you here today to the Cathedral of St. Jude the Apostle for this Palm Sunday celebration, a liturgy during which we commemorate our Lord's entrance into Jerusalem. In celebrating this liturgy today, we also enter into Holy Week, and we prepare to celebrate the sacred Triduum, those three holy and solemn days of Holy Thursday, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, and of course, Easter Sunday. I simply invite you today and during this week to walk with our Lord. And as you have just actively participated in the proclamation of the gospel at this Mass, I invite you to actively participate in the liturgies of this week. Today might be a good day to do a little bit of a spiritual review in our lives, to ask ourselves the question, how has this Lent been for me? How has it helped me to prepare for what is coming this week and what we will celebrate, of course, next Sunday? If things have not gone as you had hoped or planned, maybe you didn't keep all the promises or intentions that you have made, maybe you haven't been able to make a good confession to go to the sacrament of reconciliation, maybe you haven't spent more time in prayer than usual, praying during this season of Lent, there is still time to do that. There is time to finish well the season of Lent and to prepare for Holy Week. In fact, during this Mass today, there is a priest available in the confessional to celebrate the sacrament of reconciliation with you, if you would like. And I also believe that this week on Monday and Wednesday, as is typical, there will be the sacrament available after the 11 a.m. Mass. So there are still opportunities to go to the sacrament if you need to do that. You know, it's said that half of success or most of success is just showing up. And I think that's the case this week. So I invite you to finish Lent, to celebrate this Holy Week and the Triduum strong. May this week be for you an opportunity to grow in your understanding of and appreciation for the sacrifice that our Lord has made for each one of us. May God bless you. I confess to to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son, born of the Father before all ages. From God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, central with the Father, through him all things were made. For salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
We call on the name of the Lord as we bring our petitions to him.
The response is, Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Strengthen the church. May God increase her in number and holiness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Unite the world. May the Lord bring about his justice and peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Enlighten those who do not yet know Christ's saving love. May they come to know the promise of the Lord's faithfulness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Draw all of us gathered here closer in union with our triune God. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Bless all who have died in the light of faith, especially Cherry Fonseca. May the Lord soon welcome them into his eternal peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
And let us now offer the prayers and the petitions that we hold in the silence of our hearts. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Heavenly Father, hear and answer our prayers according to your holy will. We ask this through your Son, Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Gregory, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray that, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to enter under my roof, but only say the word. Thank you. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. And a few short announcements. Firstly, we have entered into the holiest week of the year. And we have the opportunity to just come close to the heart of Christ. If you're serious about your faith, please, if you can, consider coming to all the Holy Week liturgies. The schedule for the liturgies is in the bulletin and also online. Secondly, we didn't take up a collection, but the four baskets are around the sanctuary for your weekly contribution. If you haven't already done it online, if you're visiting today, don't feel obliged at all to put anything in. We're happy if you do, but we're just happy that you're with us today. There are coffee and donuts after Mass, and I want you to join me in praying a glory be to the Father. We'll pray it together, and we'll do it in thanksgiving for our bishop who's celebrating his birthday today. And so let's pray together. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. No.
And just a reminder that at this particular liturgy, after the blessing, we do depart in silence. And so I invite each of you to depart the cathedral in silence as well. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
The Mass is ended. Let us go in the peace of Christ.